18 months ago, these children were celebrating a very special day. The end of the Falklands War and the arrival of British troops in Stanley after 6 weeks of bitter fighting. The peace has meant a big change in the lives of young islanders. 2 years ago, few people had heard of the Falklands, and these children and their parents lived peaceful, uneventful lives.
Good, that, isn't it?
Today, their remote island home is being transformed into a fortress, which it's hoped will ensure that the islands stay British for future generations.
You don't have to pay for it.
The Falklands are only 400 miles from South America, but 8,000 miles from Britain. Half the island's 1,800 population live here in Stanley, the island's only town. The rest are scattered across the countryside, which looks like parts of England and Scotland, and covers an area about the size of Wales.
You are listening to the Falkland Islands Broadcasting Station. Well, next we've got new song, Howard Jones, number 5 in FIBS charts this week, for and a group from Steph.
Isabel Kent is a 14-year-old Falklander. Every Friday at 5:30, her record show helps to bring the island's teenagers the latest music. As there's no television in the Falklands, the radio plays an important part in their lives. All the children in Stanley go to the same school. Their school days are much like that for young people in this country, but there is one important difference.
Now, due to us being in the southern hemisphere, our seasons are all reversed, so our summer lasts from about October, that's spring, through to about March, and then it starts getting a bit cold, April, May time. We take all our O-levels in January. The weather's usually quite good in summer. It gets quite warm, actually.
There's only one thing you can say with any certainty about the climate of the Falklands.
It changes a lot. Say one day it might be snowing, and then a bit later on the day sun will be shining, and then it might start raining in the night. It's crazy, it doesn't settle down at all. But and then some days it can go for about 10 days, sunshine, no rain at all. Well, we're 8,000 odd miles from UK, and there aren't that many shops on the islands. There's no top mod shops, anything like that, record shops. Most of our clothes come out from UK, say, through Freeman's and Kay's catalogues. Our main store, the West Store, gets a few clothes in, but not that many. There's no television. Only one cafe in Stanley, and there are no buses, taxis, or trains around.
And there's only 12 miles of road, so getting round can be difficult, unless you've got a Land Rover. The islanders call anything outside of Stanley the camp, from campaña, the Spanish for countryside. Of all the effects of the invasion and war, the one that has meant most change to the lives of the children is the danger of unexploded mines and bombs that are scattered all over the countryside.
You can't go out over the camp like you used to be able to, say, go fishing or something like that, because the minefields, a few areas have been cleared and you can go over them, but okay. It's not totally safe. You can't take a good horse ride around the place, something like that.
Traditionally, Falkland children have always spent most of their spare time out of doors. In spring, collecting eggs is a popular pastime. And in the summer, there are all sorts of wild flowers to pick. But today, wherever you go, you have to be careful where you tread.
Everybody's got the chance to see a minefield map, and they've got a good idea of where they can go and where they can't.
Good morning, boys and girls. I'm Major Leslie Smallman, and I command the Royal Engineers Explosive Ordnance Disposal, that's EOD, detachment here in the Falkland Islands. Your headmaster's asked me to come to talk to you today about the dangers of unexploded explosive ordnance, UXO, unexploded explosive ordnance, which I know some of you have seen before and heard before from my predecessors, But it is a dangerous subject, and I would like to think that you all should hear it at least once a term so that you know what the dangers are. First of all, the mines. I'm sure you've all seen these signs. These signs are used for the minefields. Those two, that's the Argentinian one, that's the British one. And also the red warning triangle. Okay? P4B anti-personnel mine. Very dangerous. Those of you who knew Major Ward, that's what took off his foot. The SB 33 anti-personnel mine. The FMK1 anti-personnel mine. You won't normally find it with the yellow band on. If you do, it should be safe. Without the yellow band, it's not safe. And the number 4 Israeli shoebox mine. Now the anti-tank mines. C3B, anti-tank mine. The SB-83. So those are the mines you could find. We do find them, and I hope you don't. If you do see those, make sure you report them to us as quickly as possible. And my least favourite, which is the hand grenade, the proper hand grenade, used as a booby trap. Stick the stick in the ground, put a bit of string or wire onto the ring here, put that off to another stake, somebody walks through, they pull out the pin, that goes bang, okay?
It's an Argentinian 81mm mortar, HE. The safety pin is still in place, but as I explained earlier on to you, the fuses are liable to be a little bit dicky. I'll take you down to the pile to be demolished later.
To date, the army have found 2.5 million pieces of unexploded ammunition. They find them by digging up old Argentinian positions. New finds are made daily. These crates of rifle ammunition were discovered while we were filming. In attempting to make the camp safe again, bomb disposal squads have been working almost every day for the last year and a half. The ammunition that is unused is usually blown up.
Clear the area, please. I'm ready to prepare the charges. One and Bravo, Roger. Out.
Today, as a result of the conflict, there are 3 military to every 1 civilian, and lives change dramatically on these remote islands, especially for the young.
It was very peaceful, and there wasn't the worry of you could always go out and your parents wouldn't have to worry about you because there was no traffic or anything like that. And it was a very free and easy life, really. In those days, you very rarely got visitors, and when you did, you always knew that they were coming. But now it's changed, because with the military's helicopters, you can really get visitors any time.
Ironically, Morrill Farm is only 10 minutes helicopter ride from Stanley, but there are no roads to it, so the 9-year-old boy who lives here never goes to school.
Hello, Morrill Farm, this is Camp Education.
Camp Education, the Morrill.
Hello, Lee, should I try 600?
Yes.
Lee Malkenberg has all his lessons on the CB radio from 10 to 11 in the mornings.
Hello, Lee, yes, I think you are there all right. How are you this morning? Quite a nice morning, isn't it?
I'm all right.
Lee, can we start with reading first this morning? And let's just check on the page that you've reached. Can you look at pages 8 and 9?
What happened there?
Ben walked up the sand and he found a place, and so he got the mirror out and it was the right place. And then when he was just putting the mirror away, he seen a red flower.
So for 1 hour every day, Lee's front room that he shares with the rest of his family becomes his classroom.
And then there was a big dark hole over.
Yes, that's right. The flower magically opened a hole in the rock and there was a cave.
When he's finished his work set by the teacher, Lee's free to do whatever he likes for the rest of his day. But even in remote spots like Morrill Farm, the RAF Hercules planes flying in vital supplies and troops are a constant reminder that life is no longer the same. The 4,000 men and women who garrison the Falklands are changed over every 3 to 4 months. They arrive by sea after a 10-day journey from Ascension Island. And because of the distance from England, they must bring all their supplies with them. Most of them live 4 to a room in these floating barracks. And although there's no immediate danger of invasion, the troops are kept in what the military call a state of high readiness. The Fortress Falklands policy is designed to ensure there will never be another armed conflict in these islands. It was at San Carlos, now the site of the military cemetery, that the British started the reinvasion of the Falklands. Overnight, this remote and windswept settlement became the focus of the world's attention. Derek Goodwin is one of the 5 children who live in the settlement. When he's 11, he'll go to school in Stanley as a boarder. But until then, he and the other children are taught by a travelling teacher. The education of children living outside Stanley has always been a problem, and teachers like Hugh Marsden travel between 4 settlements, teaching for 2 weeks in each. This means that the children will only have lessons every 6 weeks. In between time, they have schoolwork to do at home with their parents helping.
8 plus 4 is... Can you use your abacus?
5.
No, 8 plus 4. Do it on the abacus. Count over to 8. That's right, 8 plus 4. Okay, whoop, that's it. Okay. Now you remember you've got 10 on the bottom line, haven't you?
And 2 so that's there.
The travelling teacher scheme is hardly a very satisfactory way of educating young children, but it does have some advantages.
In camp, you don't have so many people in the same room, so you get more individual attention. But on the other hand, you don't have so many people of the same age. So it's obviously difficult for the teacher because he may have 3 or 4 different groups. And also in some settlements, you find that you don't have any competition.
How many right angles are there in half a turn?
2.
2. Okay, that's no problem.
High in the sky over Stanley, a phantom jet goes through its paces. If this squadron of jet fighters had been stationed here 2 years ago, it's thought that the Argentinian invasion would never have taken place.
here. Very, very strong.
The Phantom is one of the RAF's most devastating aircraft. It can carry up to 8 warheads, including heat-seeking missiles, and is capable of firing 6,000 rounds of ammunition a minute. Conscious that young people everywhere are fascinated by sophisticated technology, the Air Force are pleased to show Stanley's school children around their planes and answer their questions.
It's the Rolls-Royce space system. This part you see here is the afterburning or the reheat system. Fuel is squirted into the jet pipes. If you look up, you'll see a latticework inside. And that's neat fuel, which explodes in the jet pipe here. Just
carry around
the
front of the aeroplane, then heads to walk up the
section there.
Anyone
got any questions? That's why we're here.
How many miles can a Phantom can go a minute?
At low level, not on an ordinary cruising around. We do 7 miles a minute, so we can do 9 miles a minute should the need arise. At low level, that's at 250 feet, either over the sea or over the land.
Guard dogs patrol the perimeter of the airfield at night with their handlers. To make sure that the valuable aircraft are safe, they're trained not to let go.
Stay there! We're all 5 paces backwards.
Another sort of dog altogether looks after the islanders' most valuable resource, the 650,000 sheep. Goose Green is one of the largest sheep farming settlements. It looks peaceful enough today, but it was here that the 2nd Battalion of the Parachute Regiment fought and died in the first land battle of the war. During the battle and for a month before, the children of Goose Green and their parents were locked in this hall in the community centre with little to eat and only one toilet between them. Today, the same building houses a temporary school, as the old school was burnt down during the conflict.
Lisa and everybody else? Yeah. But you'll be doing graphs like we were doing the other week, about two screens.
Andy Clark, like most of the teachers in the Falklands, comes from Britain. He has 18 children to teach, who range in age from 5 to 11. Like good teachers everywhere, he adapts the children's work to the life around them.
Georgina and Lisa, you'll be working on the tables, washing, or close by the tables, not getting in the way, right?
And that life is very much tied up with sheep farming. So today, a maths exercise is carried out in the shearing shed. The wool from these sheep is of a very high quality and brings the islands about £3 million of income each year. But until recently, that wealth was concentrated in just a few hands, and the prospects for young people were somewhat limited. It's hoped that this will change in the future.
You have to like it to stay here. It's a place for a certain kind of person. If you don't like it, you might as well go away and forget about it. But I like it here because it's free, it's not overpopulated. It's really my home, I suppose. I'm used to it, but people from England like it as well. So, you find that you get to manage without TV and things like that. And it's really a different kind of life, but it is what we know, so we like it and we wouldn't trade it for any other kind of lifestyle.
Remembrance Sunday in Stanley this year has a very special significance. The Civil Commissioner, Sir Rex Hunt, and the Commander-in-Chief of the British Forces gather together to remember those who died in the two World Wars, and especially to remember the 237 British servicemen who were killed in the battles for the liberation of the Falkland Islands. The invasion, the war, and now the vast military presence have brought the Falklands sharply into the 1980s. Whatever happens in the future, the lives of the next generation of Falkland Islanders will never be the same again.
I suppose the presence of the forces in Stanley must affect you up to a point, but of course one has to remember that it's much better to have these forces than the Argentine forces. I mean, there's really no comparison.
Their planes and answer their questions.
It's the Rolls-Royce space system. This part you see here is the afterburning or the reheat system. Fuel is squirted into the jet pipes. If you look up, you'll see a latticework inside. And that's neat fuel which explodes in the jet pipe here. Right, this is caravan in front of the airplane then. Heads to the section there. Anyone got any questions?
Well,
that's why we're here.
How many miles can a Phantom can go a minute?
At low level, not on an ordinary cruising around. We do 7 miles a minute, but we can do 9 miles a minute should the need arise. At low level, that's at 250 feet, either over the sea or over the land.
Golly!
Quite quick. Drop your weapon!
stand still! Grundy,
leave. The guard dogs patrol the perimeter of the airfield at night with their handlers. To make sure that the valuable aircraft are safe, they're trained not to let go.
Stay there! You're 5 paces backwards.
Another sort of dog altogether looks after the islanders' most valuable resource, the 650,000 sheep. Goose Green is one of the largest sheep farming settlements. It looks peaceful enough today, but it was here that the 2nd Battalion of the Parachute Regiment fought and died in the first land battle of the war. During the battle and for a month before, the children of Goose Green and their parents were locked in this hall in the community centre with little to eat and only one toilet between them. Today, the same building houses a temporary school, as the old school was burnt down during the conflict.
And everybody else? Yeah. But you'll be doing graphs like we were doing the other week, about food screen.
Andy Clark, like most of the teachers in the Falklands, comes from Britain. He has 18 children to teach, who range in age from 5 to 11. Like good teachers everywhere, he adapts the children's work to the life around them.
Georgina and Lisa, you'll be working on the tables, washing, or close by the tables, not getting in the way, right?
And that life is very much tied up with sheep farming. So today, a maths exercise is carried out in the shearing shed. The wool from these sheep is of a very high quality and brings the islands about £3 million of income each year. But until recently, that wealth was concentrated in just a few hands, and the prospects for young people were somewhat limited. It's hoped that this will change. Months ago, these children were celebrating a very special day. The end of the Falklands War and the arrival of British troops in Stanley after 6 weeks of bitter fighting. The peace has meant a big change in the lives of young islanders. 2 years ago, few people had heard of the Falklands, and these children and their parents lived peaceful, uneventful lives.
Good, that, isn't it?
Today, their remote island home is being transformed into a fortress, which it's hoped will ensure that the islands stay British for future generations. The Falklands are only 400 miles from South America, but 8,000 miles from Britain. Half the island's 1,800 population live here in Stanley, the island's only town. The rest are scattered across the countryside, which looks like parts of England and Scotland, and covers an area about the size of Wales.
You are listening to the Falkland Islands Broadcasting Station. Well, next we've got new song, Howard Jones, number 5 in FIBS charts this week, for Anna Group from Steph.
Isabel Kent is a 14-year-old Falklander. Every Friday at 5:30, her record show helps to bring the island's teenagers the latest music. As there's no television in the Falklands, the radio plays an important part in their lives. All the children in Stanley go to the same school. Their school days are much like that for young people in this country, but there is one important difference.
Now, due to us being in the southern hemisphere, our seasons are all reversed, so our summer lasts from about October, that's spring, through to about March, and then it starts getting a bit cold, April, May time. We take all our O-levels in January. The weather's usually quite good in summer. It gets quite warm, actually.
There's only one thing you can say with any certainty about the climate of the Falklands.
It changes a lot. Say one day it might be snowing, and then a bit later on the day sun will be shining, and then it might start raining in the night. It's crazy, it doesn't settle down at all. But and then some days it can go for about 10 days, sunshine, no rain at all. Well, we're 8,000 odd miles from UK, and there aren't that many shops on the islands. There's no top mod shops, anything like that, record shops. Well, most of our clothes come out from UK, say, through Freeman's and Kay's catalogues. Our main store, the West Store, gets a few clothes in, but not that many. There's no television. Only one cafe in Stanley, and there are no buses, taxis, or trains around.
And there's only 12 miles of road, so getting round can be difficult, unless you've got a Land Rover. The islanders call anything outside of Stanley the camp, from campaña, the Spanish for countryside. Of all the effects of the invasion and war, the one that has meant most change to the lives of the children is the danger of unexploded mines and bombs that are scattered all over the countryside.
You can't go out over the camp like you used to be able to, say, go fishing or something like that, because the minefields, a few areas have been cleared and you can go over them, but
okay.
It's not totally safe. You can't take a good horse ride around the place, something like that.
Traditionally, Falkland children have always spent most of their spare time out of doors. In spring, collecting eggs is a popular pastime. And in the summer, there are all sorts of wild flowers to pick. But today, wherever you go, you have to be careful where you tread.
Everybody's got the chance to see a minefield map, and they've got a good idea of where they can go and where they can't.
Good morning, boys and girls. I'm Major Leslie Smallman, and I command the Royal Engineers Explosive Ordnance Disposal, that's EOD, detachment here in the Falkland Islands. Your headmaster's asked me to come to talk to you today about the dangers of unexploded explosive ordnance, UXO, unexploded explosive ordnance, which I know some of you have seen before and heard before from my predecessors, but it is a dangerous subject, and I would like to think that you all should hear it at least once a term so that you know what the dangers are. First of all, the mines. I'm sure you've all seen these signs. These signs are used for the minefields. Those two, that's the Argentinian one, that's the British one, and also the red warning triangle, okay? P4B anti-personnel mine, very dangerous. Those of you who knew Major Ward, that's what took off his foot. The SB-33 anti-personnel mine. The FMK-1 anti-personnel mine, you won't normally find it with the yellow band on. If you do, it should be safe. Without the yellow band, it's not safe. And the number 4 Israeli shoebox mine. Now the anti-tank mines. C3B, anti-tank mine. The SB-83. So those are the mines you could find. We do find them, and I hope you don't. If you do see those, make sure you report them to us as quickly as possible. And my least favourite, which is the hand grenade, the proper hand grenade, used as a booby trap. Stick the stick in the ground, put a bit of string or wire onto the ring here, put that off to another stake, somebody walks through, they pull out the pin, that goes bang. Okay?
It's an Argentinian 81mm mortar, HE. The safety pin is still in place, but as I explained earlier on to you, the fuses are liable to be a little bit dicky. I'll take you down to the pile to be demolished later.
To date, the army have found 2.5 million pieces of unexploded ammunition. They find them by digging up old Argentinian positions. New finds are made daily. These crates of rifle ammunition were discovered while we were filming. In attempting to make the camp safe again, bomb disposal squads have been working almost every day for the last year and a half. The ammunition that is unused is usually blown up.
Clear the area, please. I'm ready to prepare the charges. One and Bravo, Roger. Out.
Today, as a result of the conflict, there are 3 military to every 1 civilian, and lives change dramatically on these remote islands, especially for the young.
It was very peaceful, and there wasn't the worry of you could always go out and your parents wouldn't have to worry about you because there was no traffic or anything like that. And it was a very free and easy life, really. In those days, you very rarely got visitors, and when you did, you always knew that they were coming. But now it's changed, because with the military's helicopters, you can really get visitors any time.
Ironically, Morrill Farm is only 10 minutes helicopter ride from Stanley, but there are no roads to it, so the 9-year-old boy who lives here never goes to school.
Hello, Morrill Farm, this is Camp Education.
Camp Education, the Morrill.
Hello, Lee, should I try 600?
Yes.
Lee Malkenberg has all his lessons on the CB radio from 10 to 11 in the mornings.
Hello, Lee, yes, I think you are there all right. How are you this morning? Quite a nice morning, isn't it?
I'm all right.
Lee, can we start with reading first this morning? And let's just check on the page that you've reached. Can you look at pages 8 and 9?
What happened there?
Ben walked up the sand and he found a place, and so he got the mirror out and it was the right place, and then when he was just putting the mirror away, he seen a red flower.
So for 1 hour every day, Lee's front room that he shares with the rest of his family becomes his classroom.
And then there was a big dark hole over.
Yes, that's right. The flower magically opened a hole in the rock and there was a cave.
When he's finished his work set by the teacher, Lee's free to do whatever he likes for the rest of his day. But even in remote spots like Morrill Farm, The RAF Hercules planes, flying in vital supplies and troops, are a constant reminder that life is no longer the same. The 4,000 men and women who garrison the Falklands are changed over every 3 to 4 months. They arrive by sea after a 10-day journey from Ascension Island, and because of the distance from England, they must bring all their supplies with them. Most of them live 4 to a room in these floating barracks. And although there's no immediate danger of invasion, the troops are kept in what the military call a state of high readiness. The Fortress Falklands policy is designed to ensure there will never be another armed conflict in these islands. It was at San Carlos, now the site of the military cemetery, that the British started the reinvasion of the Falklands. Overnight, this remote and windswept settlement became the focus of the world's attention. Derek Goodwin is one of the 5 children who live in the settlement. When he's 11, he'll go to school in Stanley as a boarder. But until then, he and the other children are taught by a travelling teacher. The education of children living outside Stanley has always been a problem, and teachers like Hugh Marsden travel between 4 settlements, teaching for 2 weeks in each. This means that the children will only have lessons every 6 weeks. In between time, they have schoolwork to do at home with their parents helping.
8 plus 4 is... Can you use your abacus?
5.
No, 8 plus 4. Do it on the abacus. Count over to 8. That's right, 8 plus 4. Okay, whoop, that's it. Okay, now you remember you've got 10 on the bottom line, haven't you?
So that's... There.
The travelling teacher scheme is hardly a very satisfactory way of educating young children, but it does have some advantages.
In camp, you don't have so many people in the same room, so you get more individual attention. But on the other hand, you don't have so many people of the same age. So it's obviously difficult for the teacher because he may have 3 or 4 different groups. And also in some... settlements, you find that you don't have any competition.
How many right angles are there in half a turn?
2.
2. Okay, that's no problem.
High in the sky over Stanley, a phantom jet goes through its paces. If this squadron of jet fighters had been stationed here 2 years ago, it's thought that the Argentinian invasion would never have taken place.
Very, very strong.
The Phantom is one of the RAF's most devastating aircraft. It can carry up to 8 warheads, including heat-seeking missiles, and is capable of firing 6,000 rounds of ammunition a minute. Conscious that young people everywhere are fascinated by sophisticated technology, the Air Force are pleased to show Stanley's school children around